Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shifting Truths by Philippa Norcross and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Amanda Ronconi. Chapter 1. Emergency departments are usually calmer than what you see on TV. If everyone ran around yelling colors and numbers and whatever else, people would die a lot more frequently. Medical professionals don't have time for that sort of thing. They're cool under pressure, calm and collected, and that's exactly what you want. That doesn't mean they don't get frustrated. Alina Kozarakis was frustrated on this Thursday night in the middle of winter. She'd only just stabilized her last patient when the ambulance bay doors slid open again, and a pair of paramedics wheeled another gurney in. This one with a young man lying on it. Not strange in itself. People from all walks of life got themselves into nasty situations, and she made a point of doing as little prejudgment as possible. "Picked him up on the sidewalk on Elm Street," one of the paramedics, David, told her as they headed for triage. It wasn't technically Alina's job, but she'd been on her way to get coffee and was in the rotation to take the next incoming anyway, so she might as well get a jump on it. "Good Samaritan called it in, said she saw him collapse from her living room window." "Drunk?" Alina peered at the young man on the gurney. He looked like he was in his 20s, with a well-trimmed dark beard and a head of thick curls to match. "He doesn't smell like it."
"Don't think so."
David shook his head. "Dispatch said the report was that he was walking along and bang, down for the count. If he was drunk enough to fall in the street, he wouldn't be walking straight."
"Hmm."
They reached an open spot and David pushed the gurney into place. Rashida bustled over from the other side of the room and began taking vitals. Alina stepped back to give the woman space to do her job. David joined her briefly before taking his leave with a nod, heading back to the ambulance bay. The nurse pried an eyelid open.
"Could be an overdose. Dilation response is delayed and his pulse is slow. He's pale, too, and his lips have a blue tinge."
"His breathing's slow, too," Alina said. "Give him naloxone. Better safe than sorry."
"On it."
Rashida pulled the IV stand off the wall and prepped it while Alina kept examining. A few moments later, both women stood back to wait and watch.
"Any minute now?" Rashida said. "Differential diagnosis, doctor?"
Alina bit her lower lip thoughtfully.
"Not sure yet. He doesn't appear to be in major respiratory or cardiac distress. So if we're lucky, we can run some blood work and find out what's going on. That is if the naloxone doesn't show any effect. If it's not an overdose, it could be a stroke. He's young for it, but that doesn't mean it isn't possible. That said, get a blood sample off to the lab. Let's get that started."
Rashida nodded and took a vial and a hypodermic syringe from the nearby cupboard. She flicked the patient's elbow, finding a vein, and was about to begin the blood draw when the young man began to convulse. She drew back, lifting the needle well away from him.
"Shit, that's not good."
Alina grabbed the phone off the wall.
"Code blue,"
she barked into the receiver.
"Code blue, ER, bay 12.
The noise in the ward picked up slightly, footsteps hurrying toward their location. And soon enough, Alina was presiding over a resuscitation. And they still didn't know who this young man was, much less what was wrong with him. So yeah, frustrating. Alina glared at the clipboard on the desk, tapping the end of her pencil against it fruitlessly.
"That's not going to get you any closer to filling in his sheet,"
Mandy said from his spot next to her. He tapped away on his keyboard and occasionally swore under his breath at the spreadsheet on his screen.
"I know," she huffed. "Nothing else is either."
"Fair. Okay, doc. Rubber duck it."
"What?"
He glanced up at her.
"Come on, you know what I mean. I'm your rubber duck. Go."
"What?
Have we seriously not had this conversation yet?"
His eyebrows raised high.
"How long have we worked together?" "Never mind, doesn't matter. It's an old programming thing. When your code doesn't work, you explain it to a rubber duck.
helps you figure out where you've gone wrong. If all else fails, you huck the thing at a wall, and it's cathartic. She narrowed her eyes at him thoughtfully.
So what I'm hearing is that if this doesn't work, I get to throw you at a wall.
Mandy paused. You don't look like you could throw me. But I've learned not to assume things like that. So let's go with that part being metaphorical when your rubber duck's a human.
Alina snickered. Okay, fine. I'll give it a try.
She turned and leaned back against the desk. Patient, biologically male, approximately mid-20s, average height and weight, European descent. Presents at ER unconscious with minor cyanosis, depressed heart rate, erratic respiration, pupillary dilation delayed but present. Naloxone administered on suspicion of opioid overdose. Patient seizes and goes into ventricular fibrillation. Defibrillation is performed and heart returns to normal activity. Patient is now comatose. Blood work shows no abnormalities that would cause similar symptoms, although he does need to up his vitamin D intake. And neural imaging shows no aneurysms. Possible allergic reaction to naloxone ruled out. Diagnosis? God doesn't like him.
Mandy snorted, then frowned.
I'm no expert, but yeah, I don't know what else that would be.
Tell me about it.
Alina sighed and tapped the end of her pencil on her nose, staring out into the middle distance as nurses and staff moved around in her field of vision.
Still no lead on who he is, either, which I hate.
I'm still not allowed to use my special set of skills on things like that, am I? Alina looked down at Mandy abruptly, brown eyes to brown, one eyebrow raised.
What? You're gonna Google white guy with beard and find something?
Ah, the admin assistant grinned. No, that wouldn't get me anything. White guy with curly hair and a beard? Well, he laughed again as Alina gave him a skeptical look. You're probably right. But you know, if you find any distinguishing markings, let me know.
Alina shook her head, rolled her eyes, and smiled.
Yeah, then you can go all Men in Black on us or whatever and pull this guy's identity out of thin air.
I was thinking a bit more blind spot, but hey, you do you.
Mandy shrugged.
What now?
He's stable for now, mostly anyway, but still in critical condition.
Alina pursed her mouth again in concern.
It's not an aneurysm. He's not testing positive for anything. But it has to be a drug, right? Maybe? Or an illness? Something's wrong with him. It can't simply be nothing.
You're the doctor. I'm the geek.
I thought you were a rubber duck.
Alina grinned when Mandy laughed.
Touché. Quack, quack.
The intercom buzzed, and both looked up at the speaker on the wall.
Paging Dr. Kozarakis, a pleasant male voice said. Dr. Kozarakis to triage.
Alina sighed, pushed herself up off the desk, rolled her shoulders, and cracked her neck.
4 more hours until end of shift, she said wearily.
Then you're off?
Mandy swiveled in his chair as she walked away.
You're funny.
She wheeled around the front of the desk and leaned on the tall counter.
After that, I find out if I'm doing a double or not. Hopefully I get 20 minutes to eat something. If not, she shrugged, on with the show.
Mandy scowled.
Our healthcare system is forked.
You're telling me, she smirked. Your concern for my well-being is appreciated, though.
He grinned, his eyes twinkling.
Maybe I wanted to take you out on a date.
Dream on, Velasco,
she said with a friendly laugh as she headed toward the ER.
Every night,
he called after her and chuckled before returning to his workstation.
Poor kid, stuck unconscious in the hospital and nobody even knows your name. What a way to go.
He hoped the kid didn't die, but Mandy Velasco was a realist. If a sunny one, and it didn't look good. Chapter 2. Maggie St. Clair opened her eyes, then rubbed them with the heels of her hands. She snuggled in under the blankets, tucked them under her chin, and sighed.
"Good morning, Joseph's Landing," she murmured, then rolled onto her side.
Bacon. "I hear you in there," Cole called from the kitchen.
"Good morning."
"Bloody morning, people," Maggie muttered.
"It's 9 o'clock,
Cole replied, sing-song. "Why is your hearing so good?" she called, then grumbled while hauling herself up and out of bed. She pulled the closet open and rifled through it, selecting a blouse and a pair of dress pants. "I'm supposed to be the one with enhanced senses."
"You're looking particularly lovely today," he said, as she came into the kitchen, still running her hands through her hair. "What's the occasion?"
"Wrapping up a few cases." She slid onto a stool at the island. "One of those supposed to look nice things, according to Pharaoh."
"Well, you're certainly that."
He came around the island and planted a kiss on the top of her head. "But then, I'm biased."
"Not complaining."
She smiled, tilted her head up, and met him for another kiss.
"Bacon for breakfast?"
"Bacon and eggs." He returned to the stovetop.
"I was about to come in and wake you up. Check how you wanted your eggs."
"Over easy, please. Do we still have any of that sourdough from Blake's?"
"I think so. It'll be in the bread box."
He pointed his spatula at the counter.
"One or two?"
"Honestly, three. I'm starving." She got off the stool and went over to the indicated bread box, a beautiful affair in carved wood, and rolled its top open.
"Yes!
Victory!" She pulled out the bag of bread and popped a couple of slices into the toaster next to it before rewrapping the loaf and returning it to its spot. Cole chuckled. Satisfied that the pan was as hot as he wanted it, he went to the fridge and grabbed the egg carton.
"Are you headed straight to clients' houses today, then?"
"Not quite straight, no." She opened the plate cupboard. "Have you eaten?"
"Nope."
"Aw, you waited for me," she smiled. "You're sweet." "Anyway, like I said, no. Office first, then dropping by where I need to drop by." Cole nodded while cracking eggs into the pan. They settled into a companionable silence as the eggs sizzled, and both jumped when Maggie's toast popped, laughing at themselves. She plucked it from the toaster and slathered butter on it.
"Toast for you, hon? Would you mind grabbing an English muffin from the box?"
He slid his spatula under her eggs and slipped them onto her plate next to the toast.
"Sure."
She did, sliced it in two, and dropped the halves into the toaster as he cracked his eggs into the pan.
"Eat up."
He slid the plate across the island after adding several slices of bacon to it.
"There's loads of bacon, so don't skimp."
"Don't mind if I do." She chuckled, grabbed a fork and knife from the drawer and tucked in, popping half a slice of bacon into her mouth.
"Oh, man, that's good."
She sliced a corner of toast off and sopped up egg yolk with it, licking her lips.
"You're too good to me. What did I ever do to deserve you?" "A relationship isn't about deserving,"
Cole chanted, eyes twinkling as Maggie joined in halfway.
"You know that, Mags. I will never complain about having someone to cook for. Cooking for one is boring."
"I wouldn't know," she teased. "I can't cook for anyone."
"I'm well aware," he teased in return,
then flipped his eggs in the pan before reaching over and plucking the toasted English muffin out of the toaster and onto his plate.
"Pass me the chili mayo from the fridge."
"Mm-hmm." Mouth full of bacon and toast, she spun on the stool and grabbed the bottle from the fridge door, then turned back and handed it to him.
"Here you go."
"Thanks, love." He took it from her, drizzled the bright orange sauce onto the open halves of the muffin, then placed an egg on either half before adding half a dozen slices of bacon to the plate. Turning the stove off, he joined her at the island.
"Coffee's just about done, by the way."
"Oh, hallelujah."
She glanced at the French press.
"What kind did you make today?"
"I went simple this morning. Blonde roast, fresh ground as always. Good for bacon and eggs."
"You're an angel."
"I try." They ate quietly. The only sounds were the clinking of cutlery and their varying noises of contentment. After swallowing the last bite of the first half of his breakfast, Cole looked up at Maggie.
I was thinking while I was cooking.
Uh-oh, Maggie joked. He stuck his tongue out at her, then turned serious again.
We're always here. Don't you want to see your own stuff?
Maggie frowned and looked down at her plate, tracing the end of a piece of bacon through the yolk.
Ah.
The truth was, she didn't. She'd shared an apartment with Matt, her twin brother, who had died a little over a year ago. After the accident, she'd spent months basically catatonic with grief, sleeping more than she was awake, barely working, and only eating because her, their, best friend, Pharaoh, kept putting boxes of takeout in front of her. It hadn't been a good time.
We never set it up very well.
She still wouldn't meet his eyes.
I don't like the kitchen much. Maybe that's why I never cook.
She looked up, trying to smile, but the joke didn't land. He frowned, looking concerned.
I can help you rearrange if you want, he offered. I have a few ideas.
I mean, if you want to?
Is this a roundabout way of saying you'd like some space? Because, you know, you can say you want some introvert time or whatever. You don't have to worry about offending me by asking me to go home.
No, that's not it, Cole said hastily, putting his knife down and reaching across the table to put a hand on top of hers.
Maggie, I love having you here. Really, I do. I don't know. I worry about you, I guess. I know the last year's been hard, and, well, if there's anything I can do to make it any easier. Plus, everyone should have their own space. I'm a big proponent of that.
She half smiled.
I bet you are. I don't imagine your mom let you have much of that.
Not really. He rolled his eyes.
That's why I got a place. And man, I had to fight tooth and nail for it. I ended up getting this place after I got the first one. And I had to pay rent on both because if she knew I'd moved out of the one I told her I was getting, there'd be hell to pay.
He sat back, looking thoughtful.
You know, I should have realized earlier that she was a bit of a control freak.
Maggie laughed.
Yeah, probably. Listen, Cole, I appreciate the thought, but I'm good. Really.
He watched her for a moment, taking another bite of egg and thinking through whatever he was pondering.
Maybe you should... Nah, never mind.
He shook his head and looked down, letting go of her hand and picking up his knife again. She raised an eyebrow.
Maybe I should what?
He met her eyes, chewed and swallowed, then exhaled softly.
Well, maybe you should move, Maggie.
Never. Maggie said immediately, surprising even herself with the vehemence of her reaction. I can't let go of the last place Matt. She snapped her mouth shut and returned to her breakfast, stabbing a piece of bacon with far more intensity than was warranted. Cole didn't say anything, but she felt his eyes on her. She deliberately kept her head down and ignored him, slicing through her rapidly cooling toast.
He's right, Mags.
Came a gentle voice in the back of her head. Not right now, Matt, she retorted angrily, and firmly shut her mental door on her brother. The silence stretched as Maggie and Cole cleaned their plates and lasted through rinsing the dishes and putting them in the dishwasher. It wasn't until Cole poured coffee into travel mugs for them both that he said,
I apologize if that was insensitive of me, Maggie. I didn't intend to hurt you or bring up unhappy memories, but I kind of blundered in there where maybe I shouldn't have.
Maggie sighed and passed him the sugar.
It's okay, Cole. I know you didn't mean it that way. I'm just still raw about it. Even after a year, it surprises me sometimes.
Grief's weird.
It sure is.
He stirred sugar and cream into their coffee.
If you ever want to talk about it, I'm here, okay? No matter when.
What about in the shower? Maggie teased. He raised his eyebrows and sealed the mugs.
Unconventional,
and not usually a shower subject, but sure. He turned to her, holding her mug out.
I'm always here for you, Mags. Whether that's talking, rearranging your apartment, or helping you move out, or being here to make you bacon, eggs, and coffee in the morning.
She smiled and accepted the mug, leaning in to kiss him.
Thanks, Cole. I appreciate it. And maybe I'll take you up on the rearranging idea. I need a little time to think about it, that's all.
Of course. Take all the time you need. He kissed her again.
I'd better get to work.
Me too. I'll be home for supper. He smiled.
For all my talk earlier about your apartment, I like how this is home now.
She stepped in and gave him a one-armed hug, which he returned.
I do too.
Chapter 3. Morning, Pharaoh, Maggie greeted as she opened the office door. How goes?
Good morning.
Pharaoh glanced up from her screen.
Not too bad. How was your night? Ready to run the gauntlet of case wrapping?
Maggie chuckled, scraped her boots off on the doormat before removing them, then hung her coat and put her mittens on top of the radiator.
Ready as I'll ever be.
The night was good, though. Cole and I watched that action movie that came out a few months ago. You know, the one with the giant robot squirrel foraging?
I do know, Pharaoh said mournfully. No respect for cinema tropes anymore. A giant squirrel? Really?
It worked better than I thought it would. Maggie sat at her desk and opened her laptop. The climax was quite good. Very exciting. I wouldn't have gone to see it in theaters, but for a night on the couch, it was fine. Pharaoh shook her head.
I'll stick with the classics, thank you very much.
Suit yourself. Maggie sipped her coffee. How's the paperwork coming?
We're nearly through the backlog.
Pharaoh clicked several times before looking at Maggie.
Just in time for you to make more, of course.
Sorry. Maggie scratched the back of her head sheepishly. It's a good thing we have cases, though, right?
Oh, absolutely it is, don't get me wrong.
Pharaoh returned her gaze to the computer.
I'm just saying it's a lot of work for two people, especially when one is the only field agent in the office.
Fair enough. Maggie spun her chair to face Pharaoh. I'd apologize again, but we do need the work. Pharaoh lifted her mug of tea off her desk and sipped, looking at Maggie over the rim.
Are you deliberately ignoring my hints over here, or...
Maggie scowled.
Maybe a little.
Pharaoh rolled her eyes.
It's not the worst idea.
I still don't like it.
We're rapidly approaching the point that we need more staff, Maggie.
Pharaoh lowered her mug to her lap.
It's not avoidable.
Do I need to take on more cases?
Maggie pulled open her desk drawer and flipped through the file folders inside.
No,
Pharaoh said hastily.
No, don't. That was a terrible joke, Maggie.
She glared. Maggie grinned.
Thank you. I am serious, though. If we need more cash to hire someone, then we should take Shelton up on his offer,
Pharaoh said.
Ugh, no, why?
Maggie groaned, slumping back in her chair and rolled her eyes.
We're already awkwardly entwined with the man. Do not make a that's what she said joke.
Pharaoh snorted.
We don't need to be even more awkwardly entwined. You know, Maggie, I feel like there's a very simple solution to all of this.
Don't say it.
You could just tell Cole.
Maggie spun her chair around with another groan.
Or I could not.
Pharaoh sighed and turned back to her desk.
Then I suppose I shall simply continue to slog away at the endless pile of paperwork.
Maggie's chair spun back around, and she leaned over, putting her elbows on her knees.
Come on, Pharaoh. You know I don't like the idea of us not being independent.
Pharaoh glanced over at her, tapping her keyboard.
Everything we've done with Shelton has turned out pretty well. I think we can trust him.
Maggie sighed.
It's not that I don't think we can trust him. No, it's that you want to do all of this on your own.
Pharaoh turned back to the screen. You've got some stick up your ass about doing things yourself. Always have. I'm a strong, independent woman. Emphasis on the independent. Your secretary is a strong, independent woman drowning in paperwork, Pharaoh retorted. Throw me a line here, Maggie. What if we only accepted Charlton's help temporarily? If we hire someone, maybe we can get far enough ahead that we'll make enough so we won't need his help anymore. Maggie drank more of her coffee and didn't reply. Finally, she said, I'll think about it. Do, Pharaoh said. Some of us have a work-life balance to think about. Maggie was still thinking about their conversation when she left the office an hour later. Boots tied up tight against the slush in the parking lot, and her scarf tucked in equally tight around her neck. It wasn't that she wasn't sympathetic to Pharaoh's workload, not at all. But she wasn't comfortable bringing Charlton in further. Not without Cole knowing what was going on. So fucking tell him already, Matt said, annoyed. This is not a hard question to answer, Mags. What are you so afraid of? She sighed, unlocked her Civic, climbed in, and set her messenger bag full of folders on the passenger seat. I'm afraid of him getting pissed off about it, she admitted. Plain and simple. We need the help, it's true, but I don't want to jeopardize what he and I have. I'm happy, Matt, and it's been a while. Matt huffed. So you're keeping secrets, which is the absolute worst way to go about building a stable, happy relationship. Way to go, Maggie. First prize, blue ribbon. Double blue ribbon, because the secrets are about his family. Maggie shifted uncomfortably in the driver's seat as she started the car and drove out of the parking lot. Yeah, I know. I'm definitely into the stage where I've let it go too long already, and I don't know how to approach it without blowing the whole thing sky high before it even starts. You're not wrong. I'm going to shut up now so you can focus on driving. Matt's presence faded into the background, and Maggie was at once appreciative and melancholic. Matt had died in a car accident in the middle of winter after their car had skidded and spun out on a patch of black ice. A semi had hit them, and Matt, who'd been driving, had died on impact. It didn't surprise Maggie that he wasn't interested in hanging around for today's travel. She wound through the streets of Joseph's Landing, waving at folks she knew and smiling at the kids playing in the snow on their lunch break, including Helena Chatham. The young girl was using her burgeoning water magic to make gleaming ice sculptures along the edge of the schoolyard. They were rather abstract, like a 7-year-old's art is wont to be, but they had charm. She had 7 stops to make. Normally, Pharaoh did most of the final wrap-up on their day-to-day cases, and Maggie only took on the ones that required a bit more of a personal touch. If there was hard news to break, Maggie broke it. But otherwise, Pharaoh reported the final findings of their investigations, collected payment, and tied nice little bows on their case files. Sometimes literally. Pharaoh didn't have the time these days, so it fell to Maggie to do the rounds. After the kidnapping case, Maggie had opted to take on a slew of simple investigations. Surveillance and fitting puzzle pieces together on the whole. Nothing horrific, nothing too dark. Most of the time, she got to tell her clients they were worrying unduly. Their spouse really was staying late at work. Their kids were out being kids. And their competitors weren't actually breaking into their storerooms at night to steal corporate secrets. People were often too paranoid for their own good. But she didn't mind getting paid to soothe anxious minds. It's a living. She pulled up at the first house, leaned over, undid the latch on her bag, and rifled through the folders until she found the one she needed. Usually, the folders would have been in order, with Pharaoh having set them up for Maggie before she left the office. It wasn't a big thing. Maggie was perfectly capable of reading a label. But it drove home Pharaoh's point. The woman was too busy. Maggie's stomach growled, and she grimaced. Maybe they were both too busy. She slumped into the driver's seat with a heavy exhale, leaned her head back against the headrest, and groaned. 7 cases was a lot. Joseph's Landing wasn't that big a town, but once again she'd run into yet another problem caused by Pharaoh not having enough time on her hands. Maggie had simply put the cases she was to close that day in alphabetical order, not thinking anything more of it. By the 4th house, she'd realized that Pharaoh had always taken the time to put the cases in the best driving order. It was nearly 4 in the afternoon, and Maggie had only now finished. She pulled her phone out to text Cole and ask if he wanted her to pick anything up for dinner. Then it rang in her hand. She groaned again, longer and louder this time, and answered it.
Great Lakes Investigations, Maggie St. Clair speaking.
Her customer service voice was on in full force. What can I help you find today?
Good afternoon, Miss St. Clair.
It was a man's voice, steady and a bit gruff. She thought she recognized it, but couldn't quite place the name.
This is Ed Kovics.
Ed. Oh. Hello, Mayor Kovics. What can I do for you, sir?
I wondered if you'd be able to meet me down at St. Damien's,
the mayor said.
If it's not too much trouble, that is.
Maggie frowned. The hospital? Why would you need... What's going on, Your Worship?
I'd rather not discuss it on the phone, if you don't mind. I think we might need your assistance, Miss St. Clair.
She mapped out the route to the hospital in her head. 20 minutes from here, or thereabouts. St. Damien's was almost on the other side of town. Still, if the mayor was asking, it was probably important. Yes, I can meet you there, she said dubiously, still feeling rather confused, and, if she were honest, skeptical. Does 4:30 work?
Perfect. Thank you, Miss St. Clair.
Of course, Mayor Kovics. I'll see you soon. He hung up. And Maggie pulled up her texts, writing Cole a very different message than she'd originally intended. Chapter 4. Maggie pulled up to St. Damien's exactly 20 minutes later, although it was another 4 minutes before she managed to find parking. Hospital parking was never easy, but it seemed as if there were more cars than usual. She wondered how she was going to find the mayor. He hadn't precisely said where he would meet her, and the hospital was a strange place to request a meeting anyway. But seeing him standing next to the front door allayed her concerns. Mr. Mayor! She pulled her hands from her pockets and extended one to shake, which he accepted. What can I do for you?
Miss St. Clair, thank you for coming. Sorry I couldn't say more on the phone. Privacy reasons. The reason I called you in is because of your success with the abductions earlier this year. The runners can't figure out what's going on, and we thought your expertise might come in handy.
Maggie raised her eyebrows. The runners were Joseph's Landing's magical police force, and they were well known for being quite good at their jobs. Maggie's specialty was looking at the really weird cases, the things that the runners didn't have time to expend resources on. If they looked at this case and deemed it beyond their capacity, well, she wasn't sure what to think. Yeah, what is going on? You weren't very specific on the phone.
Come with me.
He brought her into the hospital. The receptionist nodded at them as they walked in. Kovics didn't stop to talk, only returned the nod as he led Maggie past the front desk and through a maze of hallways. They passed the door to the emergency room and the sign for the trauma wing next to it. Maggie's heart contracted as memories of waking up looking at these same cream-colored walls with the knowledge that Matt was gone came to mind, unbidden and more than a little unwanted.
I'm sorry, Mags, he said. I'm so sorry.
It's not your fault. She closed her eyes for a moment and did her best to let the memories go.
When she opened them again, Kovics was opening a door, a private room by the looks of it. The mood in the two-bedroom was somber. Both beds were occupied by unconscious teenagers, mid to late high school, Maggie would guess. Their parents were nearby, sitting or standing near their child's bed. The long-haired blonde girl in one bed had a tall, stocky man standing beside her. The boy with the close-cropped black hair and sharp nose had both parents sitting beside the bed. Both were fairly short. The father was bald, with a salt-and-pepper beard, and the mother had straight brown hair tied in a bun at the nape of her neck. As soon as Maggie entered with Kovics, however, all three parents looked up. They still looked shell-shocked, but embers of hope flared in their eyes as they spotted her.
"Miss St. Clair,"
the woman with the bun said, her voice thick and hoarse from crying.
"Thank God you're here."
Maggie blinked and glanced at the teenagers in the beds before looking back at the woman.
"I'm afraid I still don't know what's going on," she admitted.
"I'm not sure how I can be helpful. I'm not a doctor." The tall man standing beside the blonde shook his head.
"You got those other kids back," he said gruffly. "If anyone can figure this out, it'll be you."
She swallowed and bit the inside of her lower lip. She was honored by their confidence, but more than anything else, this made her nervous. She'd gotten very lucky several times on that case. And again, she wasn't a doctor. This was a whole lot of pressure.
"It'll be okay, Maggie,"
Matt reassured her.
"We'll do whatever we can."
"Yeah, I just have no idea what we're getting into, and it's a little scary."
"Maybe you'll finally be able to pick Cole's brain. Put that nearly finished doctor of magical medicine to good use."
"Not a bad idea."
"Can you tell me a bit about what happened?" she said aloud, looking between the parents and the mayor.
"We don't know very much."
The bearded man held his wife's hand.
"We got a call this morning that EMTs had brought Chris into St. Damien's, and we got here as soon as we could. The healers haven't been able to tell us anything else since."
Maggie grimaced.
"It's been most of a day, then."
The man nodded to confirm.
"God, I'm so sorry. I can't imagine how hard this must be for you all."
The woman leaned over her husband's shoulder and exhaled shakily. Maggie turned to Kovics and said quietly,
"If they don't have any information, it might be better for me not to ask them questions yet. I don't want to make this harder on them than it already is. Is there a head doctor on the case?"
"Yes, Dr. John,"
Kovics replied.
"I think I saw her near the nurse's station when we came in. You could try talking to her."
"I think that's a good idea," Maggie said. "I'll be back."
"I'll be here."
He gave her a small smile as she turned and left the room. On her way down the hallway, Maggie reflected that it was a bit odd that the mayor seemed to be so involved in this particular case. Joseph's Landing wasn't so small that everyone knew everyone, and Kovics hadn't indicated any personal connection to the family, so Maggie wasn't sure what the deal was here. She approached the nurse's station.
"Excuse me, do you happen to know where I could find Dr. John?"
The white-haired nurse at the desk smiled in greeting.
"Sure."
He nodded to his right.
"She just left, headed that way. You're here for the Callahan girl and the Okuda boy, right?"
"The two teenagers that the mayor's been here about?
Yeah.
Can you give me any information?"
The nurse shook his head.
"Better to talk straight to Dr. John. I think she was heading off to speak to Officer Hart, which might work in your favor."
He pointed toward where he'd previously nodded.
"They're probably headed for the cafeteria."
"Thanks." She nodded and headed off. The cafeteria wasn't far down the hallway. And when Maggie entered, she spotted her intended targets almost immediately. The room was fairly empty, and it wasn't hard to spot a runner. The crisp, dark green uniform with a black leather stripe down the side of the slacks gave it away. And the runner,
presumably Officer Hart, was speaking to a dark-skinned woman in a white coat, with her tightly curled hair wrapped into an even tighter bun. So that had to be Dr. John. Dr. John? She came up to them and stopped a polite distance away. Maggie St. Clair, Mayor Kovic said I should talk to you? John turned to her and nodded, but didn't smile.
He told me you'd be along. I'm not sure what you'll be able to do here, Miss St. Clair, but I suppose more heads are always better.
The runner, on the other hand, smiled in relief when he saw Maggie.
Miss St. Clair, good to meet you. Jeffrey Hart, Master Sergeant of the Joseph's Landing Runners. Glad to have you on the case.
Not worried about Scotland Yard's professional reputation with Sherlock on the case? Her eyes twinkled, but she was half serious. She'd expected the runners to be prickly about her involvement, but this was quite the opposite reaction. Jeffrey chuckled and rolled his eyes.
No way. Part of being good at your job means recognizing when you're not so good at your job. And in this case, we're stumped. We'd rather have a case solved, even if we don't solve it ourselves.
So what's going on? No one's told me anything so far. Maggie looked between Jeffrey and Dr. John. I'd love to help, but I can't if no one tells me what the deal is.
Fair enough.
The doctor crossed her arms.
The short and sweet of it is that we don't know what's causing this. But we've had multiple cases of patients coming in over the last week and a half with overdose symptoms, but no indication of what they're overdosing on.
Maggie winced. That's not good.
No kidding.
John sighed.
Lowered and erratic heart rate, slight cyanosis of the lips and fingertips, delayed pupil dilation. We always think it's an opioid overdose.
Because we see plenty of those, too, Jeffrey said darkly.
Yes,
John grimaced.
So we give them naloxone, but it doesn't do anything. We run them through MRIs and CT scans, do full blood work panels. We've done everything we can think of, but nothing works, and nothing's coming up on any of the tests.
She sighed again, looking past Maggie to the hallway.
We now have 6, 7, I don't even know anymore. The kid who came in this morning makes it either 6 or 7. They're all in a coma, almost completely unresponsive, and we're at a loss.
What about the circumstances around all of them getting brought in? Maggie asked. The two I saw, those are teenagers. Did their parents find them?
Yes and no, Hart said. The Okuda boy was picked up on the street by amagical paramedics. They brought him to Victoria General first. A magical nurse who works there recognized him. That's how we got him transferred over here.
And the girl?
Her dad found her when he got home from work, Hart explained. Slumped over on the couch with the TV on and dinner half eaten.
No signs of obvious distress either,
John added.
None of them have been found vomiting. There's no blood, nothing.
Jesus. Maggie shook her head, hands on her hips. Is there an age range? Are they all teenagers?
And young adults, Hart said. Within a reasonable range. I think the oldest is in their late 20s. Most of them were found in similar situations to Steve Okuda, picked up by paramedics on the street or called to the club. Two of them came from Trinity. Alice called them in.
Are the cases getting closer together? Is there any sort of pattern? Maggie's fingers strayed toward the notebook in her pocket.
This has been a rapid spate of cases, Jeffrey said. The runners only got involved a few days ago.
It took us a few patients to realize there might be any connection,
John explained.
Until that point, it still looked like a coincidence.
Maggie nodded slowly.
biting her lower lip and staring at the wall between them. "Sounds like we've got a lot of investigating to do," she said at last, looking up at Jeffrey. "What do you say we each hit the pavement, then regroup tomorrow afternoon to share notes?"
"Sounds like a plan to me,"
he nodded firmly.
"We'll figure this out, Miss St. Clair. Dr. John."
"I sure hope so."
John was back to looking down the hallway past Maggie.
"I'm running out of beds."
Chapter 5.
Maggie shoved her hands in her pockets as she left the hospital. She'd left her gloves in the car when she'd arrived, and the wind had picked up while she was inside. Not a pleasant combination. Once she got into her Civic, she clapped a couple of times before pulling her phone out of her purse. She opened her texts, then looked at the time and dialed Cole's number instead. It rang once, twice, three times. She was rehearsing an answering machine script in her head when he finally picked up.
"Hey, Mags, what's up?"
"Hey, Cole. A case is what's up. A big one, looks like."
"Ah, I see."
She could imagine him leaning back, either on his counter or in his desk chair.
"Does that mean you have to call off dinner tonight?"
"Maybe." She put the phone on speaker, clicked it into the holder on the dashboard, and started the car. "I'm trying to be better about making sure I eat, but this looks pretty urgent. What are you up to tonight other than dinner?"
"Studying. I finished my magical pharmaceuticals midterm and didn't do quite as well as I expected, so I've got to catch up on that."
"Fair enough." She pulled out of the hospital parking lot and made a face at the steep charge to her credit card as the parking meter flashed at her on the way out. "Okay, how does this sound? Don't wait on me for supper. I'll pick something up on my way to the office. You get some studying done, I get some research done, then I'll come home and we can Netflix and chill."
"I don't know how much energy I'll have to chill," he teased, chuckling.
Maggie laughed. "Man, Matt and I started using that term unironically, so it's still stuck in my head as legitimate chilling. No stress, Cole. I want to crash on the couch with my boyfriend and relax."
"That I can get behind. Let me know when you're on your way."
"Will do. See you soon."
"Bye. Love you."
The line went dead, half a second before Maggie registered what had happened. She said, her brain stuttering so much she nearly missed her turn. "Did he say what I think he said?"
"He did," Matt confirmed. "He said the L word."
God, I wasn't expecting that today. She pulled up to a red light and waited, watching the pedestrian light flashing on the other corner of the intersection. "I wonder if he knew he said it? That's how these things always go in the movies."
"Couldn't tell you," Matt replied. "I'd bet either way, honestly. Guess you'll have to find out tonight."
"Yeah, because that's what I want on my mind for the rest of the day." The light turned green.
"Surprises all around," Matt said. "Isn't it just your lucky day?"
"That's the word. I bring you chai and a really weird case," Maggie announced as she pushed the office door open with her hip. "Dinner's arriving in 15. I hope you're hungry." Pharaoh looked up from her desk, both eyebrows raised.
"And if I had plans for the evening?"
The corner of her mouth twitched.
"Then I'll have to eat all the naan myself," Maggie said. "Woe is me."
"Ooh, Indian." A grin widened on the Naga's face.
"Whatever I had planned, I've now canceled."
"Did you have anything planned?" Maggie hung up her coat after handing Pharaoh the cup of tea and putting hers on her desk. "Because if you do, I won't keep you." Pharaoh laughed.
"No, I didn't. My social life isn't exactly hopping. What's this really weird case? Is it weirder than the one you solved with the ghost who wanted to swing dance all day?"
Maggie snorted and sat on the couch.
"Different kind of weird. This one's pretty dark."
Pharaoh frowned and Maggie nodded.
"The mayor called me after I finished the casework and asked me to meet him at the hospital."
"That doesn't sound very good." Pharaoh winced.
No. Kept getting better, too. She sipped her chai and sighed. Half a dozen patients, late teens to late 20s, all in comas in St. Damien's. Pharaoh hissed.
Oh, dear. Poison? Overdose?
Maggie shook her head. They don't know yet. They're stumped. They present like overdoses, the doctor told me, but all the test results come back clean. They're still looking, of course, and the patients are stable, but...
How long has this been going on?
Less than 2 weeks.
If this is going to spread...
It's going to take off soon, Maggie nodded solemnly. Nobody wants a repeat of the last couple of years.
Gods, no.
Pharaoh sighed and drank deeply from her cup.
Why do they bring you on?
That's what I asked. Maggie scrunched her nose. Apparently, my reputation has grown since the Kilmarnock kidnapping case.
Ah, you're the magic bullet.
So it would seem. Maggie's phone chimed. That must be the food. I'll go grab it.
Somehow I'm less enthused about samosas and biryani than I was a minute ago, Pharaoh said, and Maggie hummed agreement as the door shut behind her.
We are working with next to nothing, Maggie grumbled, lifting the heavy book off her lap and making as if to throw it across the room, before placing it very gently on the coffee table. How can we figure out if this is a sickness or a drug without more info? When Pharaoh didn't answer her, Maggie looked up. Pharaoh? The Naga started and sat up straight.
Oh, sorry. I think I might have found something. I got carried away in the reading.
What? Maggie asked, incredulous. She hopped to her feet and crossed the office in enough haste that she caught her ankle on a chair leg.
Ow!
Careful, Pharaoh said, but her gaze remained glued to her screen.
Here, look.
Maggie came around behind Pharaoh's chair and read over her shoulder, reaching down to rub her ankle lightly. I don't want to ask where you're looking, do I? Pharaoh glanced over her shoulder.
No, probably best if you don't.
Maggie regarded the screen with some suspicion. As long as it's not illegal.
It's not.
Pharaoh shook her head firmly. Sketchy, yes. Illegal, no. Jackpot, possibly. She lifted a hand from her keyboard and pointed at the screen.
See this? This is a list of references I've begun to collect from various sources.
Are these transactions? Maggie squinted.
I don't understand. Not transactions, only mentions. They're encoded well enough that I can't trace them yet, but I have figured out what they're referring to. A new street drug, tailored for magicals.
Maggie sucked in a breath through her teeth.
Shit. What's the timeline on these? I haven't found anything older than a month.
That said, that's only one keyword. The drug could have been on the streets earlier under a different name.
Fantastic, Maggie muttered. But hey, at least we know there's a new drug going around.
Can you get anything else from the messages?
Not yet.
Pharaoh frowned and glared at the screen.
Not beyond the fact that they're marketing it to magicals, and it's supposed to be some sort of euphoria inducer.
Like ecstasy? Hard
to say. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.